So today we're going to talk about Pascal's triangle. It's one of my favorite things in math, particularly because whenever I talk to other mathematicians, they always have some interesting pattern they like talking about. It's almost never the same one. So Pascal's triangle is sort of like an addition triangle. So we start with the number one. And every time I draw a one, assume that everything around it is a bunch of zeros. So what we do is we have one, and then we add whatever's to the left of it, so its neighbor here is zero, and we just drop that down in between them. Then I do the same thing on the right. All right, cool. Now I have two ones in this row, and I'll do the same thing. So there's a zero we can imagine here, so we drop that down. There's one in this neighbor now, so we can have a two. And then there's one in this zero to its right, so we make another one. And we just keep doing this for a while. And you can see that the triangle just keeps getting bigger. This isn't a thing that's going to stop. So we can just keep doing this for as long as we want. And for me, as long as I want is when the first double-digit number shows up, because that's when adding gets hard. So Pascal was also a combinatorist. So in particular, like problems where if I have n things and I want to choose k of them, how many different ways can I do that? And it turns out that Pascal's triangle, this really like childlike adding game, as it seems to be, actually encodes n choose k. So if I have n things, in particular, let's say I have four things, and I want to choose, let's say, one of them, then I go to the fourth row, I move over one, and that's how many ways I can do it, four ways. If I have four things, let's say I have like four circles, and I want to only choose one of them, there are four ways I can do that, right? I can choose this one, I can choose that one, I can choose that one, I can choose that one. And it turns out Pascal's triangle says if I go down to the fourth row, where like this is the zeroth row, and I choose one thing, so I move one over, then that's exactly how many ways I can do it.
So if I told you to choose two circles,
then there are six ways to do it. You notice that the sides are always ones. Like, this isn't going to change because we just keep doing 1 plus 0, and then, oh, look, 1 plus 0, 1 plus 0. And this is just going to keep happening. So we can define this entire diagonal as plus 0, because every time I go down one, I'm not changing anything. But then we get to this row, right? And we have 1 plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, because I have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I can define this row, if I felt like it, as plus 1. Then, this pattern looks less fun, right? I have 1, a 3, but the difference between 3 and 1 is 2. The difference between 6 and 3 is 3. The difference between 10 and 6 is 4. So it turns out this pattern is plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, keeps going. So around here, one may be tempted to look for more patterns, like right here is like plus, what, 3, plus 6. But that's when you start to notice what we've been doing all along, which was just adding the number to the top left like Pascal wanted us to anyway. Let's just look at something else that one might be tempted to do when they see a bunch of numbers, and that's add them in a different way. So this is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 plus 1 is 4, 1 plus 3 is 4, plus 3 is 7, plus 1 is 8. You'll notice at some point I just stopped adding because we can actually rewrite everything over here as the powers of 2. So the sum of the rows of Pascal's triangle is 2, like if I'm on the nth row and I call the first one row 0, then the sum of that row is 2 to the n. Let's just read these as numbers. Let's not add them, let's not treat them as anything else. So the first row is 1, the next row is 11, the next row is 121, the next row is 1331. And we get 14641, and then we get to this. So right now, these are actually the powers of 11 too. So this next row looks pretty frightening, because if I wrote it out just as it is, I get a pretty big number, right? Like once I put in these commas, this is around 15 million.
That's not 11 to the 5.
It's not. But it turns out Pascal, you know, his triangle doesn't quit that early. So what's happening here is that when I was writing these as digits before, I was actually considering that place value, right? Like the ones place, the tens place, the hundreds place. So I'm just going to do the same thing where I rewrite these numbers as ones and tens and hundreds place. So the first one will be 1 times 10 to the 0, because this is the zeroth row. Then we have 1 times 10 to the 1 plus 1 times 10 to the 0. So this one's 1, this one's 11. Let's do 1 times 10 squared plus 1 times 10, oh, 2 times 10 to the 1, my bad, plus 1 times 10 to the 0, that's 121. So let's skip on down to our friend here. We do 1 times 10 to the 5 plus 5 10 to the 4 plus 10 10 to the 3 plus 10 10 squared, yeah. 5 to the 10 to the 1, and 1 times 10 to the 0. And this is 11 to the 5.
So it is 11 to the 5.
It is 11 to the 5. It's just hiding. So now I have this really cool thing that I found extremely recently called the hockey sticks method, I think some people call it. It's just a really cool trick that you can do on Pascal's triangle, another result of the fact that it's the coefficients of like a binomial expansion, which is all it will make more sense once I draw a hockey stick. What you do is you pick a one somewhere on the edge and you just go down diagonally. So I'm gonna pick this one. And then I'm gonna go down diagonally and then I'm just gonna keep going. And then at some point I'm just gonna veer off. In this case, I have to veer off because I didn't draw any more rows. So the number that I veer off to is the sum of all the numbers I trace down. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 equals 10. So this row, or this diagonal rather, equals 10. So I'm gonna start with this one, and I'm just gonna veer off real quickly actually. I'm just gonna, all right. So it works on small ones. Let's use this one because why not? We can do the other direction, right? And we get 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals 6. I'm gonna do Pascal's triangle mod 2. So brief aside, mod 2 in this case is just gonna mean that every time a number is odd, I write it as a 1, and every time a number is even, I write it as a 0.
Cool,
right?
That's still a Pascal triangle, is that?
Yeah, just mod 2. It doesn't like preserve the actual value of the numbers as much, but it totally tells you whether or not something's even or odd, and that's all we care about right now. So then I'm going to outline all of the diagonals that are all ones and all of the rows that are all ones. So I'm gonna do this, which isn't the world's prettiest thing, but it's pretty nice. And this shape should maybe start to look a little familiar if you played Legend of Zelda before. It's also the Triforce. But more importantly, it's Sierpinski's triangle. So for those who don't recognize Sierpinski's triangle, I start with an equilateral triangle. I inscribe another one upside down. And then I can just keep doing this on all of the upward facing triangles as many times as I want. So yeah, this can just go on for a long time.
Cool. Yep.
And it turns out that the way that the evens and odds show up in Pascal's triangle when I convert them to mod 2, I can make Pascal's triangle as big as I want, and I'm just going to keep getting iterations of Sierpinski's triangle. So that's really cool.
That's awesome.
That's really cool by itself, but it gets cooler using the mod 2 construction. There's something else we can do in mod 2, though. In particular, we can write down the same things, but let's write them now as, we've got ones and zeros, right? Uh-huh. And for most people, ones and zeros kind of remind them of binary. So let's just see what happens when we transcribe these from binary. You know, one in binary, one. And then 1, 1 in binary is 3. 1, 0, 1 is 5. 1, 1, 1 is 15. And then the next one, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 is 17. Now, these may not immediately appear pretty cool. But if I kept going, the next one is 51, the next one is 85, after that is 255, and here I'm going to stop and I'm going to look at what these numbers are. 3 is prime, 5 is prime, 15 is 5 times 3. 17 is prime, 51 is 17 times 3, 85 is 17 times 5, and 255 is 17 times 15. So you'll notice that every time I get a prime, I go back and I just multiply by all the things that came before it, and I can generate the next, you know, n minus one entries. So the primes that we have here, actually, at least the ones that we're certain of, are actually Fermat primes, or Fermat primes rather, which means that they can be written of the form 2 to the 2 to the n. Plus one. Somehow, every time I talk to a mathematician, even 10 minutes ago when I asked a different mathematician for an idea, he told me something I'd never heard before. So even if maybe somewhere out in the world all of the things you couldn't do with this triangle are done, I don't know if there's any one person who knows them all. And maybe there's only one person who knows one of them, and we just have to keep exploring this triangle and seeing if we can collaboratively explain everything inside of it. But it's an infinite triangle, right? So maybe there are things on the 100th line down that we haven't explored yet. I feel like it wouldn't be a Numberphile video if somehow the Fibonacci sequence didn't show up. So I'm going to show you where the Fibonacci sequence is in the Pascal's triangle, because this is a Numberphile video.
Alright.
So what we're going to do is we're going to add up the shallow diagonals. So what that means here is the triangle kind of inscribes diagonals already, right? Like I can look at this one and just kind of follow this. But a shallow diagonal means that I'm going to kind of go off at a slightly higher angle than I would have if I was just following the way I drew this triangle.
Right.
So for example, the first Fibonacci number is 1, so that's my shallow diagonal. And then this one doesn't have any other shallow neighbors, so it's just by itself also. So now we have 1, 1. So this shallow diagonal is a 1, and then this one. So we do this, and we get 2. Then we do this one with this 2. We get 3. We do this one with this 3 with this one. We get 5. And you know how this game goes. So we have 1, 4, and 3 here. So we're going to get 8. I'm going to do one more in case you don't believe me. We're going to do 5 plus 6 plus 1, and this 1 down here that I didn't add yet. And we get 13.
Cool.
So there you have it, the two biggest recurrence relations in math that involve addition, probably, tied together in the triangle. They're not unique things, you know. You can have one, and it encodes the other, and it's all just related in really beautiful ways. It's so beautiful. You know, this triangle has all of these really cool properties about it. And it, again, like you said earlier, it feels like this really childlike thing, right? Like I just, you know, add the things next to me and I just plop them down under. But I've been playing with this triangle since, I want to say, 8th or 9th grade. And I learned half of these things in the past month. And there are still other things that I could ramble on about this triangle. And this isn't even my field. Like, I'm still an undergraduate. I don't even study this triangle professionally. So just imagine what people know about this triangle that I don't even know, that they don't even know amongst themselves. Like, it's amazing.